Thank you so much. We look forward to your closing number, but we've been blessed so far on behalf of the church. Thank you for coming here. I know that you guys have a busy weekend, but I'm glad that you could be here. Keep up the hard work, you guys. You sound great. One of the things I actually want to do to make them feel welcome, because you guys travel a lot, don't you? You guys travel a lot. One of the things I want to do is I wanted to decorate the sanctuary with Michigan's state flower. How many of you know what Michigan's state flower is? What's Michigan's state flower? What? Cotton blossom? Apple blossom? No, that's what the law people say. But you know what is native to Michigan? What we have in plenty, it's beautiful, it's orange, they're everywhere. We wanted to decorate. You guys have probably seen more than your fair share of the Michigan true state flower, the construction barrel, on your tours and on your journeys back and forth. And so we wanted to make it feel at home for you guys. Thank you, gentlemen, for bringing these up here. And so we wanted you to feel right at home with all the construction barrels. I know, it's not funny, is it? My message today is actually called Detours, Barricades, and Other Seasonal Annoyances. Because, let me be honest, and you guys can be honest. When you see these, what immediately comes to mind? They're not even set up yet. And you see these set up on the side of the road, somebody just drives by and drops them off. What comes to mind? Yeah, all that stuff. I actually had somebody confess to me that when they saw me unloading these, they said, I saw a truck of those driving down the highway, and I almost wanted to run that truck off the road just because I knew that they were going to find a way to mess up my day, or week, or month. Give you a perfect example of what I'm talking about here. Yes, that's exactly what I'm going to talk about. For those of you who don't know, Andrea and I live a whopping 3/4 of a mile from the church. The main road that you came in on to turn into our church, this main road right here, this is Nichols Road. You go 3/4 of a mile. It's a 2-minute drive. It's great. It can be a little inconvenient at times, but we love living this close to the church. I have a map on the screen. You can see just how close it is. We live 7/10 of a mile. I can walk it in 12 minutes. But what happened that beautiful day, right about Labor Day, was all of a sudden we look out, and these things had bloomed. They bloom in the summer, they bloom in the spring, they bloom in the rain, they bloom in the snow. They bloom all year long. And they bloomed right outside of our house. And our 2-minute drive, the 7/10 of a mile, all of a sudden we had a detour, and Andrea's drive, because she teaches in our church school, her drive took almost 10 minutes, 5 times longer. I know what you're thinking, totally first world problems, right? But it can be such a hassle sometimes. Think about the people who have to travel further. I, for example, am studying at the seminary at Andrews University. I live here, like I said, just about 3/4 of a mile from here. And I have to drive 1 hour and 15 minutes every day, 3 days a week, for the last almost 3 years to get to class. There have been times when I've had to go through 4 or 5 patches of these beautiful orange barrels. They can be such an annoyance sometimes, can't they? But does good stuff occasionally come out of construction? Does good stuff occasionally come out of detours? What I want to talk to you today is called Barricades, Detours, and Other Seasonal Annoyances, and we're going to do it all in the context of John the Baptist's ministry. The message today is all based primarily on Mark chapter 1, verses 1 to 5. If you've got your Bibles, I want you to follow along. I will have it on the screen as you see here. But before we open God's Word, let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we open your Word, speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Kelly read our scripture reading this morning. You've got your Bibles. You'll see it on the screen. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 1 to 5. It might be a little hard to read, but I'm going to zoom in and hit some highlights. Let me read it again, though. The beginning of the Gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophets. Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. John came baptizing in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And then all of the land of Judea and those from Jerusalem went out to him and were all baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. When we speak specifically about prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight, we today are the only ones who had to deal with construction and detours. Back in their day, they had to deal with construction and detours as well, but for a different reason. Let me illustrate what I'm talking about here. Suppose that we have a city in one place where the emperor lives, and then down at the end of the road is a little village. And one day, the emperor decided that he was going to travel from point A to point B. Well, what he faced, unfortunately, way too often, is when they first put in the road, there was always people along the way who made the decision to say, you know what, I know that this right here is my little plot of land. I know that this is my plot of land, but man, things are really good. If I could just have an extra couple of feet and extend my farm into the main road. Could you actually go around my road or go around my farm? And then, and of course, money always changes hands here. And then you'd have another person who said, whoa, I didn't know you were doing that. I've got a place for my cows to graze. And another person says, whoa, you can't possibly cut down my orchard. And so what do you end up with then? You end up with detours, roadblocks, all sorts of twisted and mangled paths. This is what the people of Jesus' day understood when John the Baptist came along and he preaches this message from Isaiah, is the people had long seen this idea of detours and roadblocks and everything that you have to go through. Isaiah used this same message. Prepare the way for the Lord. Make his path straight. Because what would happen when the emperor, not just common people, but the emperor decided that he wanted to get from point A to point B? Do you think he made it easy? Do you think he decided he's just going to weave around like everybody else does? Not a chance. I'm special. So he actually sent his people along to pile up, to clean up, to get out of the way. I'm not going to pile them too much higher, so you guys make straight the path from point A to point B. I've got to get it straight from point A to point B for the coming of the King, for the coming of the Lord. Make it easy. That's what John the Baptist's ministry was all about. Prepare the way. John came baptizing in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And so I've got a question for you. When we expand it out a little bit and we talk about John the Baptist's ministry, when we talk about everything that John the Baptist did and what baptism represented, was baptism the beginning? Got the question for you. Was John's baptism the beginning or the end of preparing the way? How many of you think that baptism was the end of the preparation of the coming of the King? How many of you think that baptism was the beginning of the preparation for the coming of the King? How many of you have no idea and you just want to see what Pastor says? There we go, there's some honesty. According to what we're understanding here, the beginning of this process, John came baptizing, preaching a baptism of repentance and remission of sins. It seems that baptism was actually the beginning of the process, not the end. You want me to prove it? Look up higher if you've got your Bibles open. What does it say in the verses just before what we just read? This is the Great Commission. Just before Mark is Matthew. Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20. So flip up in your Bibles if you've got them open. Go back to Matthew chapter 28. When you're there, say amen. If you need just a second, say hallelujah. I heard some hallelujahs. I'll give you just a second. And while you're turning, I do want to let you know, since many of you have asked and many of you haven't seen me in the past week, there's been many references to my hair. Yes, I shaved my head this week. Praise the Lord. Because you know what that means. I've been telling you about it for weeks now. That means that our church school brought in an extra $500. And I'm not the only bald person this week. Some of you have seen Mr. Crawford. That's another $500. And if you've been out to the Paw Paw Church recently and seen Pastor Orion, he's bald too. That's another $500. And so you know what? I will go with a little bit of seasonal discomfort. And you know what? God's given me a pretty good weekend to be bald. Because our kids are going to get new lockers. We hit our goals. Praise the Lord. All right, so you're there. Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, make disciples of all nations." And here we go. Here's how. "Baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Now, the reason I'm preaching this morning and preaching this message this morning, many of you have been aware of this. We're doing our fall seminars. We are doing our studies called The Way for Hope. We are now 9 messages in. This is the 10th message right now. Last night, we had a message where we talked about the true church. What does a true church look like? What does a true worshiping community look like? And what we ended up figuring out was that a true church, when you're looking for the true church of Jesus, it's not just a church that comes to Jesus and follows him and just hangs out in one little special cluster like a country club. It's a church that not just comes, but it also goes. A true church has both coming and going elements. And so that's what we see here. This is the end of the Great Commission. Go, make disciples. And here's how you do it. Baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teach them to observe all things that I have commanded you. When we say teach them to observe all things I have commanded you, how exhausting is that list? How many of you, for example, weren't baptized until after you understood Daniel 11? Let me see the hands. How many of you... Wait. Isn't that something in the Bible? How could you have been baptized without understanding Daniel 11? Did any of you guys have to study Daniel 11 before you were baptized? Okay. So what else? What other things were you... Surely you guys had a perfect understanding of all things related to diet. Many of you are now level 5 vegans. You don't eat anything that casts a shadow, correct? Anybody? Anybody? It's a process, isn't it? There are certain beginning points that you have to understand. When we talk about baptism, when we talk about making disciples, when we talk about being a church that brings people to Jesus, is baptism the beginning of the process or the end of the process? Is it your special graduation point, and once you've been baptized, you can sit back and say, I know it all now. I'm working on a master's degree at the seminary. I'll tell you what, the more I study, the less I realize I know. And I'm sure, Dr. Reeve, the more you study, the more you say, I have no idea what this is trying to say. Baptism, your relationship with Jesus, becoming a disciple, should be a lot like that. To recognize that once I've made the commitment that I want to be Jesus's and I want Jesus to be mine, that's where you start, that's not where you end. So, Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. Baptism is the beginning of discipleship. Next point, John chapter 3, verses 3 to 5. Get your Bibles. John chapter 3, verses 3 to 5. This is a teaching to the holy person. This is the great teacher of Israel, Nicodemus. A special man of the Pharisees, John chapter 3. I'm going to read a little bit. I hear the pages turning. John chapter 3, starting in verse 1. "There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, 'Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him.' And Jesus answered and said to him, 'Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God.' And Nicodemus said to him, 'How can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?' Jesus answered, 'Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God.' So there's a whole lot more to baptism than simply getting into a big bathtub, getting your hair wet, isn't there? There's a whole lot more than simply getting wet in the tank, isn't there? Part of baptism, part of this relationship, part of this beginning point is actually not just joining a church book and joining a worshiping community, but actually committing to be a part of Jesus and wanting the Holy Spirit to come into you. After baptism, the Holy Spirit helps us have a new life. And so what sorts of things does the Holy Spirit help us to do? What sorts of things does the Holy Spirit help us to do? We're going to talk a lot more next week. Many of you won't be able to be here because you're on the road. But what is the Holy Spirit known for? He is the one who convicts people. He is the one who comforts people. He is the one who ministers to people. He is the one who is there for us. Jesus is in heaven. The Holy Spirit is here with us, helping us along the way. And so how does he help us? How does he help us? There's a story in the Gospels that speaks of detours, roadblocks, barricades. In the Gospel of Matthew, you don't have to turn it, I don't have it on the screen. The Gospel of Matthew is the story of Jesus who just come down from the Mount of Transfiguration, and he sees a man who had been demon-possessed. A boy who had been demon-possessed, or in this case, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he's an epileptic, suffers severely. He often falls into fire and into the water. He has problems. He has barricades. He has roadblocks. He has issues keeping him from coming to you, Lord. Your disciples couldn't do anything. We humans are just humans. But the disciples couldn't do it. Lord, we need your help. And so Jesus, does he ignore this little man? Does he leave the little boy? He heals him, doesn't he? But what does he say to the disciples? What does he say to the disciples? In the process of trying to help bring someone into a better relationship with God and they'd failed, he says in there, because of your unbelief, this is why the disciples could not cast it out. For assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. And nothing will be impossible for you. I think part of the Holy Spirit's ministry is actually helping us to move the barricades, move the barriers, move the roadblocks that get in our lives. We have these natural obstacles that come from outside of ourselves, don't we? We run across issues that are outside of our control. We run across issues like fighting parents, divorcing parents. We run across issues with friends. We run across issues in church. Do you ever run across issues in your church where people outside of you try to keep you from coming to Jesus? Surely that never happens to you guys, right? I think part of what the Holy Spirit does is if you really trust in God, he will help you to have the power to overcome some of these roadblocks. I have it in my Bible as a good reminder. A grain of mustard seed, it's not all that big, is it? I actually have a couple of cups. I'm going to pass them around. I want you to take one if you want. Here you go, Janet. You can start on this side. Take a mustard seed, pass it on. A good reminder of just how little faith it takes. If you trust in God at least this much, he can move mountains. He can get rid of the roadblocks. He can get rid of the barricades. He can help you draw closer to God. That's what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit is not just some weak little power, this blowing breeze. We don't pray for the Holy Spirit to come on us so that when we come to church, we get this tingly feeling on the back of our neck and say, amen, man, I had a good church service. There's a whole lot more to the Holy Spirit than what we usually believe. And baptism and the Holy Spirit are vitally connected together. So going back to the beginning of discipleship, the Holy Spirit will help us to understand. You might be wondering, what are the basic minimums then? What are the basic minimums? We get one indication in the book of Acts. This is after Jesus had returned to heaven. He's dead. He's resurrected. He's back to heaven. The book of Acts records a story. There's a man, an Ethiopian, who's riding along in a chariot. He's riding along in the chariot, and he's reading through the prophet Isaiah. If you've got your Bibles, you're opening to the book of Acts, chapter 8. Book of Acts, chapter 8. Jumping down to verse 29. The Spirit said to Philip. The Spirit is a personal force. The Spirit is a person, not just some breeze. It is an actual person, a member of the Godhead. The Spirit speaks and said to Philip, go near, overtake this chariot. And so Philip ran to him, and he heard the reading of the prophet Isaiah, and he said, do you understand what you're reading? And he said, how can I unless someone guides me? You see the power of a community gathering together? And so Philip came, and he sat with him, and the place in which he'd read was this. He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, as a lamb before its shearer is silent. So he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation, his justice was taken away. And who will declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And so the eunuch answered Philip and said, I ask you, of whom does this prophet say this, of himself or of another man? And Philip opened his mouth, and beginning at this scripture, he preached Jesus to him. He preached Jesus to him. And that's what I've been trying to do to you through all of these series. If you've been at the meetings, you know that these aren't meetings as usual. I want you to see Jesus. Because that's what brought me into the church. As I mentioned, I was an atheist for like the first 20 years of my life. I wouldn't have come to the Daniels and the Revelations and the great controversies. I'm not saying that those are bad messages and that we should never preach them. But when we talk about relationship with Jesus, there are certain basic minimums to understand about who Jesus is. And one of them is right here. The one who was led as a sheep to slaughter. He opened his mouth and he preached Jesus to them. So verse 36. Now as they went down the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What hinders me from being baptized? And then Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, you may. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And so at that command, he commanded the chariot to stop. Both Philip and the eunuch went down to the water and he baptized them. That was enough. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He entered into a commitment. Baptism is a way to show a public commitment to Jesus Christ. You have the relationship first. You want to enter into relationship. This is your way of saying, Jesus, I like you. I want to get to know you better. Can we hang out, maybe change our Facebook statuses? I'll mention on my religious beliefs that we're together. It's a baptism is a public way to show a commitment, much in the same way that marriage is. When we talk about public commitment, you've seen this picture before, some of you. This is a picture from 7 years ago. I almost said 7 months because time is just flying. 7 years ago, 3 months, 21 days, give or take, Andrew and I were married. You had hair. I had hair. I know, I actually had a lot of hair back then. Was that the very first day that I met Andrea? Okay, it wasn't the first day that I met her. At that point, did I know everything about her? It's somewhere in the process, isn't it? Do you think I knew more about her on my baptism date, or do you think I know, on my wedding date, or do I know more about her right now? I'd like to think I know more about her right now, although I still make mistakes, don't I? Some people are saying amen. I don't see her around here because she just said a hearty amen on that one. But what we're saying here is baptism is a public commitment to say, I'm in a relationship with you, Jesus. This is not the point where I sit back and say, all right, I know it all. I got it all. I'm covered. I'm good. Baptism is the start of a lifelong process of developing your relationship with Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit will be here to guide you, to direct you, to help you through. And so when we turn back then to our theme passage, Mark chapter 1, verses 1 to 5, we go back to those keywords. Those keywords are prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. And so I ask you, when I speak to you about detours, barricades, roadblocks, do you want Jesus to come into your heart? Jesus is point A, your heart is what point B. What are these detours doing in the way? What are these barricades doing in the way? Some of you will even know. They're more than just barrels, aren't they? These are more than just barrels blocking Jesus from coming into your heart. They may be some of the things you watch, some of the things you listen to, some of the things you do, but you've got these barricades that are keeping Jesus from coming into your heart. From Jesus, Jesus wants a straight path into your heart. He stands at the door and he knocks. He's waiting. He's waiting. Is he going to make you move these barricades out of the way all by yourself? Is he going to give you help? That's what the Holy Spirit's for, right? The Holy Spirit's the one who will help you move those mountains if you just ask for a little help. And so I'm asking you, some of you have already been baptized, and you let these barricades continue to climb back into your life. You continue to build up these barricades that keep Jesus from coming to you every single day. You think to yourself, we got married at one point. That's good enough. If I hadn't seen Andrea in the last 7 years and said, well, we're still married. We got married. That's good enough, right? You think she'd be happy? If I didn't talk to her for the past 7 years, do you think we could still consider ourselves to be in a relationship? We need to, every single day, ask ourselves, if you've been baptized, we need to ask ourselves, why are we still building up these barricades? Why? What do they represent? What do you need to give up? Why? And ask for help to move them. For those of you who may be contemplating and thinking to yourself, okay, I've been baptized, but I've strayed so far from Jesus that I need to make a recommitment. I need to renew my vows with him, and you might be considering rebaptism. I want to ask you, what barricades are stopping you from making that decision? What barricades are keeping you from drawing closer to Jesus right now, today? You don't have to move these by yourself. The Holy Spirit will help you. And for those of you who have not ever been baptized, those of you who have never given your life publicly to the Lord Jesus Christ to say, you know what, I want to be in a relationship with you, and I want it to be a meaningful relationship. I want it to be a relationship of every single day getting together, talking, growing together. I know I'm not going to be perfect, but your Spirit is going to guide me. Your Spirit's going to be with me. Your Spirit's going to direct me. And it's by your strength, Lord, that even those barricades can be moved. Lord, I want you to prepare the way for me. I want you to make the path straight for me so that you can come and dwell in my heart. What I want to do is we're going to turn it over to Glaw for our closing song. They're going to do a special music number. And what I want you to do is I want you to consider, for those of you who have already been baptized and you're thinking about what it means to die daily, to pray for the Holy Spirit to be with you, to help you to overcome the barricades. They may be but small ones to you. But ask the Holy Spirit to help you to die daily. But for some of you, you may say, you know what? I need to do something bigger. I need Jesus' help to do something bigger. I need a mountain moved in my life, Jesus. Can he move mountains? How are those mustard seeds doing? You still going around? I see some back in the back. Wonderful. Just that much faith, just that much of a relationship with Jesus is enough to move any mountain that you're carrying in your life, that's keeping Jesus from having a straight path into your heart. If you have not made the public declaration, or you've so far walked away from Jesus that you need to make a public stand, and you need to say, Jesus, I need you. I want to be yours. I want you to be mine. I'm considering a further commitment, baptism, rebaptism, profession of faith. I'm considering some sort of commitment. I want you to, during this song, I want you to sneak off to the sides. I want you to come back to the back. I want you to meet me in the back. I want you to listen along. I want to meet you. I want to pray with you. I know that you guys are going to do a great song. If one of you may have been touched by this message, I'll meet you at potluck. I don't want you to leave here without knowing that you have a relationship with Jesus Christ today. For those of you in the pews, slide off to the sides, meet me in the back. I want to have a special prayer with you. I'm going to turn it over to Glaw. Have you asked Jesus to move the barricades, to make straight the path so that he can come into your heart?